Welcome to another Nature Discovery Screencast. Look over my shoulder and watch as I look for the pure beauty found in nature from the raw videos taken on one of my photo walks. The date of this photo walk was March 18, 2017, and it took place in several locations around Cabarrus County, North Carolina, and that is in the United States. Okay, let's jump right into it today. We are using Final Cut Pro on a Mac, and we're looking for the gems from the raw videos. After the videos are produced, they are used in the Nature's Wild Things website, where we're building a visual nature field guide to life. To see the production techniques used to produce 30-second nature videos, check out the 30 Seconds of Nature screencast, also found on the Nature's Wild Things website. And we're going to start off today with the lowly housefly. When I do these nature walks, my goal is to stop and take video of anything that moves. And if there's interesting plants around, sometimes I take videos of plants just sitting there in the sun and the breeze. As we work toward building out a field guide here at Nature's Wild Things, we're looking to get all sorts of critters into the act. And these are interesting little flies when you really look at them up close. This guy's just going through a process of cleaning up here a little bit, looking around and moving off. So what we're going to do is we're going to take and just put an in by hitting the I on the keyboard here, and an in starts off a spot where we're going to use the video possibly at some point in the future, and right about there we're going to put an out. And we're going to mark this as a favorite. You can see over here in the browser, a green bar has appeared, and that indicates that that is now a favorite and will be kind of separated out from all the cutting room floor material, you might say. And an eastern-tailed blue. That's the butterfly here in the picture. Very, very small. We're talking thumbnail size. And oftentimes you see them fluttering around around you as you're taking a photo walk or out on the hiking trail. And what you see is a purple kind of a blur as they're fluttering around. Well, as you can see, when he opens up his wings there, his upper wings have a real predominant purple color to them. The lower part of the wings, the underside, has white with black spots and a couple splashes of orange there. And really predominant purple, though. And we like to try to get a butterfly. We like to try to get his underside of his wings so you can see what they look like when they're sitting like this, because people often observe these creatures and they see the underside or they see the top side, and but they don't see both. And we like to put into one video both of them. And here this video kind of demonstrates what they look like. So let's take the spot where he's just starting to open up and make that an in. And I don't think he flies off. I think he just sits there. There's about the widest that he's open. Make that an out. Call that a favorite. Now let's go down here, a completely different butterfly. And he's just sitting with his wings closed. Now this is an orange sulfur butterfly. And let's just take a look. Is he going to take off and show us his inside wings? Now you just saw that it goes pretty quick. Let's do this in super slow motion, one frame at a time, 60 frames per second video. So we're seeing 60 individual photos in a second. And look at this. There he opens up. So now you can see the upper side of his wing. A beautiful little orange spot there. A beautiful yellow coloring with black around the edges and a big black spot in that upper wing. Beautiful, beautiful butterfly. Now this is just something you don't ever see with the naked eye. You really need to be taking a video of this, and then you need to do what I'm doing here and just go at super slow motion. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 660th of a second is what we have to work with there. But we can make a video out of that and really show off what this beautiful little orange sulfur butterfly looks like. So let's, we got an ant walking through the frame there. Let's go right to the spot where he's just going to start opening up there. Make that an in. And we'll make that the out. We'll call this a favorite. Now, we go right up to the creek here now. And we find a pair of mating water striders. Now, if you think this is rare to find a pair like this mating, you're kind of wrong. All spring long now, I've been seeing these water striders in our little creek. And they're always mating. reading up on them a little bit, they can be in that mating position for months at a time here, it seems like. Later on in the summer, you find them individually. I guess you can call this swimming around. They're little micro hairs on their legs and their feet there. And these micro hairs actually allow them to float on water. They use their front legs as paddles, almost like you were rowing a rowboat. And they're just skimming around. Now, when you're taking video of two little small creatures like this on the water, oftentimes the camera has trouble focusing. It's trying to focus on the reflections on the water, on the critters, and oftentimes you see the camera go in and out of focus. So we have to take just a little segment where they're better focused and call that a favorite. So we can get the fact there that they're mating. There's two of them there. We can see him using his legs to propel himself with, and then they kind of go out. Let's just make that an out for now, and we'll call that a favorite. And we can work from there. We could also skim through and find some more locations that potentially could be favorites, but that's the water striders. And they're out in the winter, they're out in the spring, they're out in the summer. These guys don't seem to be affected by cold. I've seen them out all times. Here's an entire video clip that seems to be out of focus water striders. So we're going to take and we're going to move that one to the trash. Don't need to keep that one around. Okay, now we have a little bird appear in the tree beside us. I think it's a little song sparrow. Never does sing for us, but just a pretty little picture of a song sparrow sitting on a vine there. And he's just looking around and looking around, and then flies off. Kind of got the feathers on his head kind of perked up there, sitting in the sunlight, just looking around, looking around. Yeah, are we gonna fly off here yet? Yeah. Let's see how much of the takeoff we can see. Not too much of it, but we'll call that an in and call right about there the out. Call it a favorite. Let's see what else. Now we move over to the Carolina chickadee. Also landed in the tree not too far from us. And does a takeoff for us too. You can actually see that I've been practicing with the camera and the focus. You can see that there's a blurry spot in front of his lower body there, and that's actually branches and twigs in front of the bird, between the camera and the bird. And the challenge when you're taking a shot like this is to get the shot in focus, get the bird in focus and not focused on the branches in front of or behind him. And I've been having more and more success lately. I've kind of trained myself the process of doing that. And with a lot of practice, you can really make a camera work for you, even a simple point and shoot with autofocus. Now, there's several ways you can set up an autofocus on a camera, and I have mine set up centered so that it's trying right in the center of the picture to focus. You can also set these cameras up to be more a wide pattern of focus, but then when you're trying to shoot a bird like this, it tends to be focusing on the wrong things. So learning how to focus, how to find an object at the similar distance as your subject, a bigger object, to focus on it, hold the shutter button down, hold that focus, get over onto the critter you're trying to take some video of, and really establish a good focus with the kind of the camera end of things, then switch on the video recording and it should find and hold that focus for you. And with a little practice, you can make it work. There we see them flying off. I love the way they kind of fly and then they sort of just bomb through the air when it's appropriate. He's flying, 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 but here he just tucks his wings and let's just bomb over to the next twig, next branch. Okay, we'll call that an out, and we can call that the in right at the beginning. So we have another favorite. Now we're back at the creek side here, the reason for all the sand, and a little leaf, and we're only a few inches above the water level in the creek here. And again, we have the eastern tail blue, different shots of them here. And you can see just kind of sitting there in the sun. And with this clip, you can actually, again, see the top sides. You can see how they have two sets of wings, the top set and the lower set. And the lower set, they're often moving, I believe, to predators to make himself look more fierce. I'm not sure on all this, but you can often see them moving the lower wings independently of the top wings. And there you can see the side view, and kind of does a complete turn for us there. There he's kind of almost like moving those lower wings back and forth. It looks like they're not coordinated either. It looks like the left side's going up and down differently than the right side. Little things you can notice it in the slow motion end of things here. Let's just start that out as an in and let him, there he takes off. I wonder when he takes off, let me make that an out. I wonder when he takes off whether we can, what we can see of that takeoff there. Just kind of flexing his wings and getting ready. We're going in one frame at a time mode, slow motion here. And see the stripes on his antenna? So he actually looks around first. I don't know if he spotted something. He spotted a mate flying around. Oftentimes you see them in pairs when you do find them. And see the upper wings and off he goes. All right, mark that whole thing a favorite there that we just selected. And now he's flown over to a mineral deposit on the bank of the creek. Oftentimes you see these little discolorations in the soil and you wonder what it is. And I believe a lot of the times it's some sort of mineral deposit. And these little butterflies will sit there and they'll unroll their little tongues out and they'll be sopping up some of the minerals found. And in this case, I think we have this guy out of focus the entire time. There's another interesting looking fly flying around him. Again, he's kind of out of focus. You can see the camera's got the focus on the sand grains up to the top of the picture really good, but not very good on the butterfly. So we're going to just move that one to the trash and take a look at the next video. Here, that's the one we just were at, and here he's sitting all by his lonesome in the sand. And let's just go backwards here a little bit. See what we can see of him flying there. See by his antenna, he's looking around. When you see still photos of these beautiful little creatures, you don't see the nuances of his head turning and the range of motion they have in their heads and the body flexing and sometimes when they take off, you can see how they hold their body. Sometimes they stick that tail of theirs way up in the air. I don't know if we can see it on this one. Yeah, there he's got it up in the air a little bit. All right, let's call this a favorite. Now we're back, just looking at this beautiful little butterfly. He's moving around. You can see better, this is a better picture of his wings and the, almost like the vein structure of the wings. We're back to the mineral deposit. Oh, what do we got here? We've got a lot of action going on with his lower wings there. He's out of focus, in focus. We'll make that an in. So when one goes up, the other one goes down. When the other one goes up, So they're he's kind of moving them. He's not moving them together, but he's moving them independently. The top ones seem to be pretty stationary, but the lower ones are moving up and down. We also have a little photo bomber show up here in the picture. I think there's a couple of them flying around. There's one crawling around to the right of them there. Just a little bug, a little fly of some type. And I think we have a fly just flying around in the picture, but he never really is in focus. So okay, so we'll make that an add and a favorite. Let's see, we got the same butterfly, I think, sitting on a log this time. You can see with the eastern tailed blue, you can see why we call them blues. But the reason we call them tails is at the very lower wing there's tiny little tails on each wing, kind of blowing in the breeze there. And that is an indicator of the species of butterfly oftentimes. Tiny, tiny, tiny little tails. Beautiful, beautiful little butterfly. And again, these butterflies are not much bigger than the size of your thumbnail. They're not big at all. They're some of the smaller butterflies you'll find flying around. Now, let's see where he just flies off here. There are the heads going again, looking around. Up the legs. I don't know if you notice that, but they oftentimes stomp their front leg. And then they'll fly off. Just an observation when you've watched the butterflies in slow motion as much as I have. All things you would never see just by watching a real-time clip of the butterfly. Call that a favorite. Now, walking along the trail, I came within inches of stepping on a lizard that I didn't even realize was on the trail. And he scooted off as quick as he could, jumped on this tree right beside the trail, proceeded to climb up about 2 feet, and then there you can see he's really winded from the run. I observed lizards before, but I don't know if I've ever seen him breathing as hard. I think I scared him, and I think he had a little run to make over to the tree. And he's checking me out to make sure I'm not going to get any closer, because he couldn't run too much further. I think he's winded. Beautiful long toes with little sharp pointed nails on them. There I'm trying to just pretty much holding the camera, and then I'm trying to clamp it down a little bit on the tripod. He was close enough that you really see the scale pattern. You see his eye down below his eye there, right at the fold of his neck, is a little hole. I think that's their nose. I think that's where they breathe air into the lungs. See the rough looking scales on the front of his head there. Couple little discolored scales on there. Love the way the eye independently moves around. There he turned his head, but then he can swivel his eye around and look at different things. So we've got three little videos of this guy. He wasn't going anywhere fast, so we were able to take some video of them, and we have some different places where we can create a little video if we want to out of them. And kind of like, we're gonna just mark this one. And out, we'll call that the favorite out of the group. And we always have the option of looking over and putting together a story, you might say, from the videos. And we have the option of taking the best one. Here's one where we're pretty much just out of focus and we're focused on an ant. Okay. Let's just, don't need to keep that one in the library. All right, let's. Now, I'm in the very edge of the woods, and I'm trying to take video of a squirrel up in the tree behind some branches, and the squirrel's just sitting there eating a nut. And you can hear from a long distance away their little scraping or rubbing sound of their teeth on the shell of the nut. And you can tell there's a squirrel here somewhere, and they're often sitting on a horizontal branch, and they're just gnawing away at this little nutshell to get at the meat inside. And just to my left, I catch the fact that a bird has just flown up about 6-7 feet away from me and landed on this log I was standing near. And it turned out to be one of our mourning doves. And so I started to take some video of this beautiful, beautiful bird here. And I wanted to get some video for the website, the field guide. And this gave me an opportunity to get some good close-ups. But just took some video of the individual bird, and it's a beautiful bird. I'm just going to take a little segment there and call it a favorite to kind of mark it. And there he's sitting in the sunlight. You can tell he's close by to me. A little bit of camera movement as I'm at an awkward position. I'm shooting 90 degrees from where I was planning to shoot. So I was standing in a very awkward position trying to get the camera locked down. And yet he was so close, I just didn't want to scare him away. So I was trying to move very slowly. It was just, that's why so much camera movement there. And then he proceeded to walk like 2 feet away from me on the ground, and looking around and just picking around at stuff on the ground. You can really see when you look from a distance, the crown right above his bill, and I keep calling it him, but I'm not sure if this is a male or female, and I don't know how you tell, but the feathers right above his bill kind of poof out, and from a distance it almost looks like he's got a big brown thing stuck on his head. You wonder if it's a it looks like a boil or something, but it's actually little feathers in there. And they kind of poof out. And just sort of picking around at the ground. And then he jumps up on the log next to me here and proceeds to preen himself, where they're just I believe working the feathers, and I might be wrong here, the oil glands around the base of the feathers. And I also know that these birds in the wild, they're exposed to lice and all sorts of things that can annoy them. So a lot of preening going on with these birds in the wild. And just sort of sitting contently looking around. And there we got a little, I tried to move a little bit to get a little better angle on them. There's still branch in front of them. And see them doing some serious preening there. And see that little, almost like a lump above his bill. You can also see when they're preening that they have a kind of a skin or a membrane that can close over their eye to protect their eye. See the feather pattern on the back there really well. And now we've moved up to a rock. And moved away from the rock. That's because the one was nearly at my feet. Not even able to get a focus. He was so close to me, I was having trouble focusing the camera. And then I'm off. Something catches my eye just above the above their heads, the dove's heads, and it's a towhee, a male towhee, but I was never really able to focus for more than an instant there, and he flew off. So we're not even going to need that piece of video. All right, and so we have the one sitting on the rock here. And then the bird moves over to a different rock, and he's preening himself. And you can see his feathers all poofed up there. And doves, you always see with a partner. You never see a dove alone. They, I believe, partner for life, and they always are. Wherever they're going with their partner. Here he's getting all fluffed off here, and I think that's what happens right about here. The partner shows up on the same rock. So the two of them are going to be on the same rock. And I know through watching them in the past that they will show affection for each other when they're close together. So I was trying real hard to make sure I didn't scare them off to see what would happen next here. And then here comes the other one. Let's just watch this in real time now. So they kind of dance around each other, but the one comes over and wants attention. It's about the only way to put it. I had to actually pull the camera back a little. They were so close to me. So I was having trouble focusing, but these two proceed to keep each other's attention, you might say. And again, I was having trouble focusing. And I think as they get together, the focus comes into work again. So the one kind of pecks at the other to say, hey, turn around. And they proceed to do this process, which I learned is allopreening. And in the breeding season, allopreening helps to strengthen the pair bond between the male and the female. I'd never really observed this before. And it's used as part of the courtship process. Now, I wished that vine wasn't in front of the birds. I wished I would have had an opportunity to kind of move the camera to the right a little bit, but there were obstacles in the way, and so it's not the perfect video, but it is nonetheless a very interesting video, the way the birds allopreening the other. Again, I'm not sure. I'd have to do some research on if you can tell which is the male and which is the female. It almost looks to me, maybe size-wise, the one that's closest to us is the might be the male, but I'm only guessing at that. And we'll watch this one here too. This is just a continuation of it. I think I did try to move the camera just a hair, and then the birds moved behind the vine again anyway. Now, this is an interesting stretch that they both do. They lift one leg up. Let's look at that one again. I've seen this before where they will lift one leg up, stretch it behind them, fan out the tail feathers, lift up the wings as if they're stretching them, and they're both doing it. Now, I don't know if this is part of the courtship process or they're just stretching. I don't know. This is occurring right after the allopreening. Let's go back to watch this in real time. And then the one bird goes over, pecks the other, and the other bird takes off. Okay, had enough fun for today, I guess. I don't know. So we're going to have a lot of good video there to put together a sequence, tell a story about some of the courtship moves between mourning doves here. I believe we have another Nature Discovery screencast in the can.